Elizabeth, who's here this morning, her family was with us this summer as we camped at Shallow Bay. I don't know how many of you have ever gone to Grossmoor National Park and camped at Shallow Bay. Well, they have a beautiful beach similar to your Northern Bay Sands. And we slept in a tent, brave souls that we are, and we lucked upon some very good weather. And in the mornings, we would play on the beach with the little grandchildren. You saw the little boy wandering around this morning. Well, he's Charlie, and he's our little two-year-old grandson, and the little girl, Annie, is our granddaughter. Well, Annie and I would walk the beach. And one day we decided that we would walk the beach and we'd walk up and we'd collect seashells. I have them because anything that Annie and I do together, I can throw away because she may ask me at any point, show these to our congregation, she may ask me at any point, Nanny, where's the seashells that we collected? Well, here they are in a fancy bag and I keep them in my office. As we were going up, of course, I was saying to her, look, Annie, look at that seashell. Isn't that beautiful? And we would pick it up. So we picked up seashells like that. We picked up a seashell like that. Here comes Charlie. We picked up a seashell such as that. And all of a sudden, Annie decided that she was going to start herself. She didn't want me showing her what seashells to pick up. So she started to pick up shells like this little one, like this one, like this one, or this one. So I thought I was going to teach Annie a real good lesson on what constituted a good shell. So I said, Annie, you know, these shells are broken. We need to pick up these shells that are beautiful. She looked at me. And she said, but Nanny, these shells are beautiful too. And right away, the Spirit of God, I tell you that this is absolutely true, the Spirit of God convicted me, and the verse that we read in Scripture, a little child shall lead them, became applicable to me because I realized that I bought into what this world considers beautiful. And that is anything that's perfect, anything that is not broken in any way. But I'm thankful this morning for a God who doesn't think like that. You see, that's not the story of the God that we serve. We are imperfect people loved by a perfect God. We read it this morning in Romans chapter 5. I love, as I said, that passage of Scripture. But that last verse that I read, verse 8, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This whole Bible is a book about redemption. Right through all of its pages, God wanted to communicate this to his people. Though you failed him, and how you failed him, and we feel it, don't we? Though you failed him, and how you failed him, though you failed him, God loves you. The proof is Jesus. So look at Jesus, and learn from Jesus that God loves you. We've enough people in our world to put us down. We've enough people to recount for us our mistakes. But if you want to know that you're loved, you look at Jesus Christ who gave his life that we might be redeemed. Theologians and Bible students alike sometimes refer to what they call the scarlet thread running through the Bible. And by this, they mean that the Bible stream from Genesis right to Revelation is Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for the redemption of mankind. The blood of Jesus Christ runs right through the Bible. So why is redemption so important? Why is it the theme of the Bible? It's because we all need it. I remember when I was a young adult how foolish I was. I used to look at certain people and think, my, are they ever broken? Can I ever see their brokenness by the way that they behave? However, with conviction from God and maturity in my spiritual life, God has helped me understand that we're all broken. In some way or another, we're all broken, me included. And it is within that brokenness that we sin. Romans 3 in verse 23, Paul said to the Roman church, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." You see, the big deal is that not only are we all affected and marred by sin, sin has incredible consequences. You just ask people who are chained by some sin. Right from the very beginning, God showed us his response to the ugliness of sin. And his first response to sin, to our first parents, Adam and Eve, was one of punishment. To Adam and Eve, it brought shame, it brought guilt, it brought fear, it brought separation from God, it brought a broken body, broken nature, and eventual physical death and spiritual death. You know, all that was not meant to be a part of the human experience. All of that came after the sin of our first parents. It brought separation from God. In Genesis chapter 3, verses 14 to 15, which recounts for us the fall of mankind, here we read God's response to the serpent. God told the serpent, "Because you've done this, you're cursed. You're cursed beyond all the cattle and wild animals. Cursed to slink on your body and eat dirt all your life. I'm declaring war between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He'll wound your head and you'll wound his heel." You see, at the same time that God outlined judgment upon his creation, he made another response. God responded with the promise of a deliverance. And that's what these verses that I just read was all about. These verses which speaks about war, enmity between woman and between the serpent, which represented Satan. And that the offspring of woman, Jesus Christ, would wound Satan. And we read about it in Isaiah. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquity. He was bruised, but the ultimate victory came through his resurrection. And because of his resurrection from the dead, we no longer have to face death and sin and hell. He is the ultimate deliverer. So right at the very beginning, God promised deliverance from sin. This is the first promise in the Bible for the coming of Jesus Christ into his world. God proved that he loved his world too much to leave us in such desperation and penalty. God always had a solution for sin. You know, the sin of Adam and Eve did not catch God by surprise. He knew when he created mankind that they would fall. That baffles my mind. Why would God ever want to create something that was going to cause him such desperation? And I can't answer that, but I do know that even as he created mankind with full knowledge that he was giving them the choice that they could make to love him or not to love him, God still created him for perfect fellowship with him, and God had a plan to redeem mankind right from the beginning of time. And God began to forecast the Redeemer at the first evidence of sin in his creation. Do you know that there is a 4,000-year period between Adam and Jesus Christ? But during that time, God was far from silent. During that time of human history, we see the scarlet thread of redemption as God used illustration after illustration, deliverance after deliverance, to foreshadow the ultimate deliverer, Jesus Christ, whose blood would cleanse us from all sin. But there were times in that period of history that it looked as if God was more interested in destruction than deliverance. So often, my friends, we forget that God's intrinsic nature is one of holiness, is one of love, and is one of justice. And he cannot turn a blind eye to sin. But it is always true that judgment is always preceded by intense, earnest entreaty for people to come back to him. There was a flood during that period of time, which we often link as only being God's punishment and judgment. But it is one of the greatest stories of redemption found in the Bible. There was 120 and 20 years of preaching by Noah. We don't realize the time span. But there was 120 years of preaching by God's servant Noah before the flood. He was entreating men and women to seek the safety of God's provision, which was the ark, before the storm of judgment. But despite the fact that there was room for many people on that ark, only 8 were saved. And so we look at our world today. Redemption and salvation are offered to everyone who are willing to repent and believe. However, few accept the offer. What is it Jesus said? Narrow is the gate, and few there be that find it. But God would not give up on his world. Let me say, he's not giving up on his world today. This still is our Father's world. And although the wrong seems off so strong, God is the ruler yet. 350 years after the flood, we find another great promise of deliverance. God spoke to Abraham, and it's recorded in Genesis chapter 12, verses 2 to 3. Another promise of the Savior. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all the peoples will be blessed through you. Again, the promise of Jesus Christ, the promise of deliverance. But in this period of waiting for Jesus Christ, let me tell you, God was not silent. Over and over again, God responded to his children when they called on him. You know, one of the great truths I've learned from God's word is that God always responds to the cries of his children. I've experienced that personally. Many of you here would say, yeah, that's true. Sometimes I don't even see it until after the fact. And then I look back and I say, oh, wow, God opened that door. God did this. Perhaps not in the way that I thought he was going to do it. But so very often, I see it after. Our YPSM reminded us this morning a little story that she told us, not here, but outside, speaking about her own husband, who she prays for so very often. And one of her sons was sick. And it led her husband to lie on the bed and watch one of our live stream services from our core. Seems like that much, you know. But it's God's moving. And Charlene thanked God for that incident. God works over and over again. God is always striving for the souls of his world. And some of you may say, you know, I've got loved ones and I have prayed and I have prayed and I have prayed. And they're not saved. We come here Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and we have a small congregation of people. Don't give up. It's like the chorus we sing, God, don't give up. You're on the brink of a miracle. God is always striving for the souls of his people. We can never measure what God is doing because we can't see it. But God moves people to come to him every single day and maybe using your prayers, I believe. Finally, God responds with deliverance. I love the way God calls Moses to his great task. You know, the 3 million people who were in Egypt, enslaved during the last 430 years by the Egyptians who were treating them so harshly. And God calls Moses to lead these people out of bondage. Now, Moses was a fugitive in Egypt. Moses had been in Egypt. He was raised by the Pharaoh and Pharaoh's daughter. And he had an elevated spot in Egypt. But because he took justice in his own hands and he killed an Egyptian who was abusing one of Moses' own people, the Israelites, then he had to flee for his life. So he fled Egypt and lived 40 years in the desert. And God speaks to Moses through a burning bush. And God says these words. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. You know they must have felt forgotten. 430 years in bondage. Surely they had cried out to their God for deliverance. But this is what God says. I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way that the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, he says to Moses. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. Isn't that a beautiful picture of the God that we serve? I have heard them crying out. I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them. And his ultimate deliverance was Christ on the cross. He who knew no sin was made sin for us so that we could become the righteousness of God. That's the story of redemption. I've only just highlighted a couple of places in Scripture, but the Bible is full of the illustrations of this story of redemption. But we can't end it here because we have a part to play. So now go, God said to Moses. Moses had to be petrified. What? You're sending me back into Egypt? I've got a price on my head. They're going to kill me if I go back into Egypt. And he offered all kinds of excuses. Like, God, I'm not eloquent. I can't speak. Send Aaron, my brother. He's better than me. And God said, Moses, you go. Who made your mouth? So often we feel that way, don't we? When we're trying to witness to people. I can't do that, Lord. I'm not eloquent. How can I possibly make sense of the gospel? So I feel every time I preach. And God says, who made your mouth? Who gave you the brain power that you have? And besides that, it's not what I say. It's not what you say. It's what God's Holy Spirit, which is actively involved in witnessing every time we speak for him, it's what God uses and interprets to people's hearts. There's a story my husband gave me a number of weeks ago now. He said, Bert, read this. It's a true story. I've used this before. Francis Dixon, a Baptist preacher in England, was conducting revival services in a church in Sydney, Australia. During the service, a young man, Noel, shared his testimony. Noel was in the armed forces and was stationed in Sydney, Australia. He was walking down George Street. They got a George Street here, there too, not our George Street. But he was walking down George Street one day when he was stopped by a white-haired man, and the man said, excuse me, sir, I wonder if you might let me ask you a question. I don't mean to offend you, but if you were to die today, where would you be in eternity? The Bible says it will either be heaven or hell. Think about it. That's all. Have a good day. Toodaloo. Noel thought about the question that the man had asked and went and found a church in Sydney, Australia. The pastor explained how he might accept Jesus Christ as a Savior and Lord of his life. And as Noel shared his testimony, another young man, Peter, sat in the audience. And as he listened, Peter said, hey, that man has my testimony. After the service, Peter came to Francis Dixon and Noel and said, I too was walking down George Street one day and was stopped by a white-haired man who asked me that same question. I invited Jesus into my life as a result of that man. Francis Dixon went to Adelaide to preach in revival and told the story of Noel and Peter and how amazing it was that these two men both were saved as a result of the witness of this white-haired man. As Dixon told the story, a man in the audience raised his hand and said, I was walking down George Street in Sydney, Australia, when a white-haired man stopped and asked me the same question. I went and I found the friend who told me how I might accept Jesus as Savior and Lord of my life. Francis Dixon went on then to Perth, Australia, and related the testimony of these three men at the revival services he was conducting. After the service, a deacon in the church came to him and said, "I too was in Sydney, Australia one day, walking down George Street, when this white-haired man asked me the same question and went on his way. I knew I had to settle that question and went and I found a church where the pastor told me how I too could accept Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord." Francis Dixon continued to be astounded as he traveled from city to city and related this story as he preached. In his own church, he told of the many who had come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord as a result of the witness of this white-haired man on George Street. After the service, a woman came and told her pastor, too, that she'd been walking down George Street and made her decision to accept Christ as a result of the haunting question of this white-haired man. Dixon was speaking at the Keswick Conference, a Deeper Life Conference, and told the story of the white-haired man on George Street. A man in the audience came and told Dixon that he, too, had been walking down George Street in Sydney, Australia, when the white-haired man stopped him and asked him the same question. As a result, he also accepted Jesus as Savior and Lord. After the conference, Francis Dixon went on a world tour. He spoke in a meeting in Jamaica. There he met a man who accepted Christ as a direct result of the same white-haired man. From Jamaica, Dixon went to India to speak at the missions conference. And one of the older missionaries at the conference heard Dixon tell this same story, how many people came to follow Christ as Savior and Lord because of the witness of this white-haired man on George Street in Sydney, Australia, who had been faithful to ask the question, "If you were to die today, where would you be in eternity?" The missionary said, "I too was in Sydney, Australia, walking down George Street and was confronted by this white-haired man, and as a result invited Jesus Christ into my life." Francis Dixon was totally overwhelmed by the faithfulness of this white-haired man and became determined that he had to meet this one who had been the instrument of God of leading so many to the Lord. On his way home from his world tour, he stopped in Sydney, Australia. He looked up one of his friends and he asked the friend, "Do you know a white-haired man on George Street who stops people and who asks them, where would they be in eternity if they were to die today? The Bible says it will be either hell or heaven. Think about it." And that's all he says. Toodaloo. Then he walks on his way. Dixon's friend said, "Yeah, I know that man. That's old Mr. Genter. He can't get around very well, and he can't see very well, but I'll take you to see him." The two men went to Mr. Genter's home, where Francis Dixon told the old man of his travels over the world and the many who had come to know Christ as a result of his witness. Mr. Genter began to cry. He told the men that this was the first time he had ever heard of anyone who had accepted Christ as Lord and Savior because of his witness. But he was faithful anyway. That's a true story. You see, in God's kingdom, success is not based on what we see as a result of what we do or speak. You see, God calls us to be faithful, and in his time, he makes that faithfulness fruitful. It is irrelevant if we see the result or not. Our call is to speak about the redemption that is found in Jesus Christ. You know this fact? People are much more open to the gospel than we realize. We are way more hesitant than we should be to speak for Christ. You see, it's not about our competence, just as it was for Moses. It's about his faithfulness. It's about him preparing the hearts of people, wooing them to himself. I very often read this quote when I feel insecure about something that I have to do. It's a quote about by Augustine. I have it taped on my computer. It is this: beware of despairing about yourself. You are commanded to put your trust in God and not yourself. When Isaiah was called, this was his call. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, here am I. Send me. Are you willing to make that kind of a commitment for Jesus Christ? There are people in your schools. There are people in your work settings. There are neighbors. There are people in your own family that God is preparing their hearts. And just as he said to Moses, now you go. He looks at every single one of us. And when you get a prompting to call someone, or when you get a prompting that maybe I should do this, do it. Because it is often God's Holy Spirit speaking to your heart. I was in the hospital this week, and I was sitting down at a table with other people. And this lady, very quiet lady by nature, looked at her husband and said, dear, do you see that man over there? He's sitting alone. Go over and offer him a coffee. And he got up without hesitation. And he went over and he said, sir, I wanted to buy you a cup of coffee. And that man's face lit up and he could hardly believe it. Not always the big things that we do, my friends, but it's the little things that can. And God is able to take it just as he took the loaves and fishes, such a small offering the little boy brought that day. And he was able to break it and bless it and use it to feed 5,000 men. And then add on to that women and children. Are you giving God your best? Are you giving God your all? Are you faithful? We've got a world out there that needs Jesus Christ, that needs to be redeemed. We're living in a dark world, and it seems to be getting darker and darker, and Jesus said, you're the light of the world. Are we doing our part? Are we reaching out? Are we speaking for him? I want us to sing today the song, All to Jesus, I Surrender. There are two things, my friends, that we're doing at our core in these days. Number one, we're preaching holiness of life, because the greatest witness we have is our lives. And people notice more than we realize what we do and what we say. So we're emphasizing holiness of life. And we're emphasizing prayer. Two key components in order to be faithful to God. And so this morning we're going to sing it, All to Jesus, I Surrender. We can get so distracted in our world. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. I surrender. Are there those this morning who say, I need to pray for someone? On Sunday evenings now, we've got a prayer box, a simple box. We lay it on our altar, and we have paper and pen by it. And every Sunday evening, we say, do you have someone you want to come and pray for? Do you want to write their names? We're not going to look at it. But God will respond to that little act of faith. Names of their children. And people come and they write their own concerns. They write their own confessions. And they lay it in the box for God to do his work. Do you have that kind of faith? I do. I'm praying for some precious family members, not my children. I'm thankful they're serving the Lord. But some of my nieces are not where I know they should be. And I'm praying for them. And I put their names in that box. And do you know God has already opened up some doors for me, and I've had the opportunity to gently encourage them in their faith. And so I say to you this morning, do you want to come and use this, This mercy seat is a time of prayer. Both the people from Lower Island Cove and their own people, is there some concern you have on your heart this morning? Or do you want to say, Lord, please make me what I know I ought to be, wherever I am, for you? Let's just bow our heads and just have a few moments of prayer this morning. I gave my life to preaching this gospel when I was 19 years of age. I entered